Welcome to another inspiring message with Pastor Deborah Bell from Deo Gloria, South Africa, as she brings you a word from God.
We love you. We can't get enough. All this is for you,
God. We give you glory in this place. Kurande shete bando bresha kaba sete bashandai kuhoroboshe. We've just been singing, we love you. And what's the word?
Can't get enough.
Can't live without you. Can't live without you. And then the next one is
for you.
All this is for you. You hear what we're singing there, saints? We love you.
Never stop.
We can't get enough. All this is for you. This morning, I want you to ask the question, what is the all this is for you that you're giving to the Lord? What is the all this? Hallelujah. What is the all this? What is the all this? We're singing, Lord, I love you. I can't get enough. All this is for you. All this is for you. How many of you know that you can't give an all this to God if there's an emptiness inside you? That's why I keep preaching about the fullness. Because unless we're full of something, we've got nothing to give. Amen? We have to be full enough of something to give something. And so some of us might be singing and thinking, even as apostles just said those words, what do I have to give? What have I given? Lord, all this is for you. What is all of this? What is all of this? Think about it for a moment. What is the all of this that is for the Lord? What is the all of this? What is the all of this part that you can say, Lord, I have taken so much from you? It sounds weird, hey? I've taken so much from you. We can say it another way. Lord, you've given so much to me. Lord, you've given so much for me. Or we can say, Lord, I've taken so much, because giving is still somebody receiving. There's a presence in this house this morning. The Lord said, April. Some of you have been waiting for years. And the Lord said, I've given you the courage to speak to that mountain. Now do it. Do it. This is the first Sunday in May. So it's the first Sunday after the April. And a lot has happened in April, friends. There's a lot that's happened in April. There's a lot that's happened in 2014. Honing, shaping, putting us on that potter's wheel. Sometimes it's spinning so fast, we're saying, Lord, just get me off this thing. I've had enough molding. I've had enough pressing in. Haven't you honed me and pushed me in? Isn't that enough, Lord? But the safest place you can be this morning is on the potter's wheel. The safest place you can be is on that wheel. Because it's not a wheel of fortune. It's a wheel of foundation. Who do you say I am, part five? I've entitled the subtitle of this message carrying on the series this morning, This Is My House. Yes. You see this shirt? This is my house. I see all of you wearing your This Is My House shirts. Hallelujah. Those that have them, the rest of you, some of you that have the EGFC shirts, you're wearing them. That's awesome. This is my house. This is my house. I can't get enough. Lord, I love you. I can't get enough. All this is for you. All this is for you. Everything that I am. For Lord, you have said, I cannot give a sacrifice of my life, for you've already given that. But I can sacrifice in my worship. What is contained in that sacrifice of worship? When I say this is my house, what do I mean? Because we're talking about who do you say I am? So we're living, we're talking about the I am in me. We're talking about the great I am. We're talking about the revelation of what that means for us as the body of Christ. What it means for us as individuals in the body. What it means for us to be a body. And I said to you that at some point I was going to talk to you in this series about the rock. Do you remember? And last week I mentioned just a few things, and I'm not going to rebuff the rest of the series. You've got that on video if you want to watch it, or it's on our podcast. We also have podcasts which you can grab off iTunes, and I'm not sure if they're on our web as well, but they're also on audio on the web, right? So they're on our web or on iTunes. You're welcome to subscribe to them, and really just if you don't have time to watch video, you don't have the space on your ADSL or your whatever, your Wi-Fi, you can always do podcasts and get the messages you might have missed. I want to encourage you. This entire series has been quite profound because I really believe that the Lord, this has been molded from the heart of God, this series, Who Do You Say I Am? And so we spoke about last week the believer's authority, the authority we have in that powerful name of Jesus, and how that name is really the key. It gives us the keys, the access points to bind and to loose. And I spoke to you from Matthew 16, our key passage. And this morning, and I mentioned just briefly, I mentioned a little bit about the rock and the meaning of that. And I want to just dwell on that for this message this morning, because you're saying, hey, I know that there's some point where you're going to talk about the seven keys to breaking strongholds, and I've got it. Every time I do my preparation for the following week, that's where it starts. I copy and I paste all my notes from the previous session, and I start going for it. And as I start going for it, the Spirit of God begins to lay new things, and then I just keep moving that down. So it's here. It's not forgotten, but I have to do this in the order that the Lord gives me. So Spirit of God, we thank you for your presence this morning, that you are here. We thank you, Lord, that you are right there, even in the living rooms, in the bedrooms, the verandas, the gardens of all those watching online this morning. Your Spirit is present. We thank you, God, that you are a God that is with us. You are a God of greatness. You are a God of glory. We ask you to bring your word to life in us, to us, and through us this morning, in Jesus' name. Amen. And so we spoke a little bit about the believer's authority, and I even mentioned to you how often we can have misused authority. And so authority can be a very bad word for some people because it's been so misunderstood and so misused in our lives, just generally. You know, it doesn't have to just be in the church, or it's, in fact, it never usually starts in the church. It starts from that molding of our childhoods, and where authority structures have been punishment, and they haven't been used in a healthy way. And so all of a sudden, we come into a church environment where it's the Lord teaches us how to live in a healthy way. And with the responsibility of carrying the name of Christ, there's an accountability. There's a responsibility that comes with that name. And so all of a sudden we find ourselves under the guidance of leaders who are called in the Word of God in 1 Thessalonians 5, 12 and 17, and in 1 Timothy 5, I think it's actually verse 17 in chapter 5, in Hebrews 13, verse 7 and 17, we find the instruction that the Lord gives us clearly that is the Word of God, which is how leaders are supposed to maintain and what their function is, what they're supposed to do in the body of Christ, and that is to guide people, to give them godly counsel in the way that they should go, because surely your pastor should know what this word of God says and should guide you into the truth of it. Amen. But that's not always a comfortable journey for some of us, because a healthy church and healthy leaders will always guide you and lead you in the way you should go, leaving you to make the decision so that you are empowered. Amen. That's healthy, is leaving you, the empowered one, to make the decision. Does that make sense? So no one should ever tell you what to do. If you ask for advice, people can give you their opinions, and brothers and sisters in Christ can always do that, but never let a spirit of manipulation take you away from what God has ordained for you. You'll know, you'll feel a discomfort that is not pleasant, and I'm not just talking about the one where we are hurt and not healed because authority structures haven't been good. So we spoke a bit about that last week. And then I just wanted to share with you, this is what it says if you read with me in from verse 15, where we know that the whole scripture we read from verse 13, when Jesus came to Caesarea and Philippi and he asked his disciples, who do people say the Son of Humanity is? And of course, some replied John, some said Elijah, others said Jeremiah. And verse 15 says this, chapter 16 of Matthew. Thank you. But what about you? He asked, who do you say I am? In verse 16, Simon Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Didn't just say Messiah, he said, you're the Son of the living God. I recognize you through the Spirit's power and through the revelation of the Spirit that you are one of the three. You are one of the three. 17, verse 17, Jesus replied, blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this wasn't revealed to you by flesh and blood, but by my heavenly parent God in heaven. And now we come to this key verse for this morning. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not. That's it. So here's what it translates to. And I tell you that you are Petros. Petros is the Greek word P-E-T-R-O-S, and it's the Greek word for little stone. Little stone. So I tell you that you are the little stone, and on this, the word for rock here is the Greek word Petros with an A, and it means giant stone. So here's what it is. And I tell you that you are Peter, the little stone, and on this giant stone, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not overcome it. This is a powerful, powerful passage, because people get very confused. You can do many exegesis and sermons and messages on this, and we can talk a lot more on this passage. But for now, I want you to just keep that in mind. So in essence, what Jesus is trying to explain to them in a nutshell here is that I've called someone with the character of Peter to be the human being that I would use, someone of his character, to be the human being that I would use to build on the foundation of who I am. I'm Jesus. I'm the cornerstone. I'm the rock. Amen? And of course, the church referred to as the rock. Do you know that the church is the only institution that has been born out of heaven? The church is the only institution, not the mosque or anything else. It's been the church. Amen? Amen? Because this is what we know is foundational in the Word. And I'm not going to go into the whole revelation of what he was saying there. I just want you to get that for now. This is who Christ is. Christ is the cornerstone. Christ, the Bible says, is the chief cornerstone. It's only on the foundation of Jesus Christ that we can build a solid foundation. The cornerstone is Jesus. The foundation we read last week, Ephesians 2:20, is the apostles and the prophets. The two offices that have been left out of the church for so long. Amen? And so we see them coming, making a comeback now, and I'll teach you on that another time when we do the fivefold school, and I might just do a sermon series again on that. And if you're all here, you'll actually get it without having to enroll in the school. But we don't want that. We want you to enroll in the school. Amen? So you've still got that question in your mind from the song that we sang. All this is for you. We love you. We can't get enough. That's a giving action from the Lord. We can't get enough of what you're giving, Lord. all this is for you. What is the all this that you're building? What is the all this that's coming out of you for the Lord? What is the all this that you have inside of you that God has been busy impregnating you with all the years that you've been in this church, all the months, all the weeks you've been in this church? What is the all this? What is the all this? And I want to talk a bit about that. I want to talk about it because a cross-reference to this entire passage in Matthew 16 regarding the church and regarding what I've read to you is a cross-reference in Isaiah 22:22. You can make a note of it. The cross-reference of this text is this. It says, "And the key of the house of David I will lay upon his shoulder, and he shall open it, and no one shall shut it. He shall shut, and no one will open." So whatever God opens, no one can shut, and whatever God closes, no one can open. And this is where it tells us that Jesus is the key of David. Jesus has the key of David. That's what we receive by revelation. And what that means, the passage in Isaiah 22 that is linked to it, is that this is the preamble to what Jesus was explaining in the prophetic words in Amos 9 in the Old Testament. And even as we go further, these are words that relate to how the church is supposed to have been built. That's why there's a cross-reference and a linking. Are you all with me? Yeah. What am I talking about? I'm talking about the church this morning. We can talk about a lot of things in the church, but we're going to go with what the Spirit wants this morning. So I know that God knows what's on your hearts. God knows what we need to hear, and so I'm going with that. And so I want to say to you this morning that long ago, even in Amos 9, where we see the prophetic word, where the Bible says that the tabernacle of David will be restored in the days to come. Now, most charismatic Christian churches, prophetic, Pentecostal, apostolic, whatever you want to call us, the Spirit-filled groups of churches believe that we are living in the times when the tabernacle of David is being restored.
Hallelujah.
Now, why is that important for you to understand? It's important for you to understand because I'm teaching you this morning that the tabernacle of David was very different to the old temple. It was a very different, in the old temple, there were three different chambers. There was the outer court, there was the inner court, and there was the Holy of Holies. And God was very, very specific about the tabernacle, about the temple. God was specific in that God gave very clear instructions about the colors to be used, about the furniture that needed to be put inside there. Lots of different furnishings, which we'll go over in another teaching. And right in the very, very Holy of Holies, which was behind a curtain, that God again had given specific design and colors and even the type of fabric, there was an Ark of the Covenant, which was the place where God's presence dwelt. And I want to do a whole teaching on this for you because it's very, very powerful to understand what the difference is and how God's glory is for here and now and what God's glory meant for them. In those days, the glory of God dwelt in a specific place. It dwelt in the temple. God was much bigger than that, but God allowed part of who God was to dwell in that inner part, in that Holy of Holies. And that's why only once a year only the high priest could go in there to offer the atonement, the sacrifice of the blood sprinkled on the mercy seat. Are you with me? As an atonement for the sins of the people, only once a year, because it was the Holy of Holies. It was the sacred place. It was the place where God's glory dwelt. So if you went outside the temple, the glory wasn't there. If you looked inside a person and through their eyes, the glory wasn't there. It was only in Moses. The glory was upon Moses, but it wasn't in Moses. Today, you and I have the glory dwelling in us. That means it can dwell through us. What are you doing with what God has given you this morning? Hallelujah. Come on, church. God has given us so much. If we can understand what is in us, the I am in the I am. And so when we see David's model compared to the temple of old with all these rules and regulations and furnishings, we see something completely different. We see the model of David's tabernacle had nothing in it but the Ark of the Covenant. It was a tent. In other words, no walls. It meant there was a significance. God never gave a whole lot of rules and regulations. There was 24/7 worship in that temple. And the glory of God, the Shekinah glory, dwelt round about there, 24/7, not just specifically at a specific place. The whole tent was filled with the glory of God, accessible to all who would worship. Are you with me? And why they used David's model as a tabernacle to be restored in this day is because that is exactly what it is about. It's about the Shekinah dwelling, the glory of God coming into the house of God, not with rituals, not with all sorts of adornments that make the place look good, although we have a spirit of excellence and all of that. But it's not the stained glass windows. It's not the wooden carved benches. It's not the human adornments that make the temple holy anymore. It's not the ritualistic stuff that we put in front. It's not what we do in that way. It's what's in the hearts of people to worship the living God, to come and say, Lord, all that I am I give to you, because no longer do I offer the sacrifice of bull and goats or whatever you had in those days. If you weren't rich enough to have an animal, you would give a pigeon, whatever it was. Now we come, the Bible says, we are living sacrifices. What is your sacrifice to God? It's your worship. It's your worship. And if your sacrifice of worship is right, if your posture is right, that's why the Lord's been teaching us in an order all these things since 2012. I will never forget the teaching, because the Lord taught it to me first, where I gave you the 7 P's of what God was doing. Remember going into 2013? Do you remember we had that service at Pastor Ty and Jay's place? The Christmas service, when we didn't know whether we were going to have a place or not? Isn't it significant that we stand here today and I say to you, your sacrifice of worship is the most important thing you can lay before the Lord? Because the sacrifice of worship comes from the heart, cannot come from the flesh. The flesh will do the outside adornments, but the heart reaches the heart of God. So that's just to give you a preamble, because I'm going to tell you a little bit more about David's tabernacle in a bit. But why I wanted to explain that to you is because it's so important we have an understanding of what God wants from us. God's not interested in rituals anymore. God's interested in you saying, Lord, we love you. All this is for you. All this is for you. That's what sacrificial worship is. It's saying, Lord, all this is for you. Because if I understand that concept, I've got it. When I've got all this but nothing's inside, I what can I give? What can I give? When I haven't understood what love is about, what can I give? When I haven't been healed in my heart of the stuff that has tormented me, what can I give? When I'm not prepared to take the steps of faith, when I get godly counsel from my leaders, what can I give? Here's what I want to say to you to bring that together in a nutshell. Jesus spoke about the church being built on the rock. The rock is Jesus. The church is built on Jesus. Amen. The giant rock, Jesus, the cornerstone. And the heart of Christ was that the church be one. The heart of Christ was that the church be one. Irrespective, you can have whatever denomination because of human issues and whatever, division. Instead of multiplying, we should never be dividing the church. We should be multiplying. We should be reproducing ourselves. Amen? Now I want to talk to you this morning. I want to bring that into your heart, because that means when we talk about the church being one, it requires working together. Because this is the passage about how the church is built. This Matthew 16 is about how the church is built. And so when you talk about your church and a sense of true belonging, what does that mean for you this morning? What does it mean for you to belong to a body of Christ? And not just a body of Christ, this body of Christ specifically. What does it mean for you this morning? Why would you want to be a part of this body? Why are you a part of this body of Christ? Because I want to tell you, you can only say, this is my house. When you use the word my, You use the word my when there's something that belongs to you or you belong to it. There's a sense of belonging. This is my house. There's even a sense of possessing in a good way. Can I use the word in a good way? Are you with me? This is my house. I can only use that word. I can only say this is my house when I'm prepared to take ownership of something. But if we're giving nothing of ourselves, no sacrifice, how can I call this my house? There is a thing that I always say, this is the family of God. Before it is anything else, this is not an institutional organization that is built on administration. It only has administration because it has to function in a healthy way. Amen? So that we are taking full responsibility for everything God has put in our hands. But it's first a family. How can it be anything else? And if it's a family first, what comes first in families? Yes, relationships, love. Love. See, that was the other thing Jesus spoke about. He said, love one another. Love one another. And if we've come out of a place where we haven't really understood what love is, or we've had a really bad version of love in our lives, and we haven't really been given, how can I say, a healthy understanding of what that means, we're not going to understand what it means when we come into the church. And we go through a whole phase of growth, of learning how to trust people again, and learning what it is to truly love each other, and learning what it is for people to actually love us without us, without expecting anything back from us. How many of you know that even when you've come into this church right in the beginning, you might have had some very unrealistic expectations? And as you've grown and as you've healed inside, you've realized, hey, wow, I've received freely. So what does that now say? Oh, I like the first part, Lord. I've received freely. Then the Lord says, now give freely. Now give freely. You've heard us use that in terms of monetary giving, and I'm not going to shy away from that ever. I'm not shying away from that because Jesus spoke so much about money in the New Testament. And you don't have to believe me. You need to go and research these things that I teach you. Amen? So I'm talking about ownership. I'm going to come back to that scripture in a moment. But if we're giving nothing of ourselves and we're not involved and we don't want to be a part of, there's no sacrifice. How can I can't say with conviction this is my house. I can't even really go there. And what will happen is when I leave here on a Sunday, all I'll do is walk back into the flesh. I won't be a witness to anybody. I won't have anything to say to anybody because I'll be empty inside. Because I haven't allowed whatever's inside of this house to come inside of me. Are you with me this morning? I'm talking about deep truths this morning. Is that okay? So here's what I want to say to you. Let's put it in some modern terms. Can I get a little bit kind of off the edge with you, just so you know I'm not completely loony? It's a synergistic relationship. Write that down. It's a synergistic relationship. Let me tell you what a synergistic relationship means. Here's what the word means for those of you that don't know. It means acting together. Whoa. Tell your neighbor, we're acting together. It means acting together, people, groups, or companies working together in a creative, listen to this, innovative, and productive manner for common purpose, benefit, or goal. I'll say it again. It means acting together, people, groups, or companies working together in a creative, innovative, and productive manner for a common purpose, benefit, or goal. It's working together towards a common end. Have you got that? It means various parts working together to produce an enhanced result. What do I mean by that? You can't produce an enhanced result on your own. It only comes if you work together. The kind of result, listen to this, the kind of result that comes from working together, you cannot accomplish on your own. That's what the enhanced result means. Listen, that's good. Are you hearing me? Now, many of us have shied away from teamwork because, and working in teams and working with people because it feels safer for us. Amen, someone. When we come in, we're going, listen, I'm cool on my own. Just let me tell you the body language. This is how easy it is for us to pick up these things. I'll come into church for the first time. I'll say, oh, yeah. The first sign is this. There's a physical manifestation in everything. And we usually will kind of distance ourselves, isolate ourselves. We'll do whatever needs to be done to protect ourselves, right? See, because working in teams means risking for us. Means that we have to start building trust. That means we might be let down. That means we might be hurt. I don't need any more of that in my life, do you? So isn't it easier to just stay away, just be independent? And so often the breaking point or even the tipping point for people, some people, and I use the word glibly here because I want to explain something. The tipping point for some is actually going backwards. They get to that point where they can move forward into a completely free dimension of what God has for them next, or when they get to that point and they have to make those hard decisions, they move right back and they leave. This is what happens. That's the life cycle of the church. I see just recently, what is his name? Pastor Rick Warren. He is Saddleback Church, one of the largest churches in the world. I think it's the second largest church in the world. I think he has something like 30 to 40,000 members in his church, if not more. That was a couple of years ago. And one of the things he does is he states reasons why people leave the church. Now, if people didn't leave, he wouldn't have to state reasons. Hallelujah, someone. And there can be lots of things. People relocate. They this, they that. But here's the poor pastor standing up here, and the congregants come and they go, why did so-and-so leave? Why did so? You know what I do now? I say, ask them yourself. Hallelujah. Because most times people leave, I can tell you now, besides relocating, it's because they come to that point where they have to make some radical decisions and finally take those steps of faith that they've feared for so long. Why? Because our action is either fight or flight. Amen? And most people go, flight. Hallelujah. Goodbye. I'm not soaring on the wings of eagle. I'm flapping out of here. Hey? You know what I'm saying? Some people say, listen, you can choose eagle's wings. I'm flapping right out of here. This is just too hard. This is one mountain that I can't climb. And we said, don't climb it, tell it to move. Anyway, but that's another story, but just so that you understand, that is the called the revolving door in a church. And when a church is not huge, it's so much more noticeable, amen? If one or two or three or four leave or something like that, you see it. It's noticeable. And so it's like, oh, where are they now? I wonder why they left. Don't even, the moment someone starts talking to you like that, look at them and go, excuse me a moment, and just leave the conversation. You do it. That's the best thing to do. If you stand there listening to that twaddle, what will happen is you are in agreement with it. Yes. You don't even listen to it. Yeah, unless you're prepared to defend it. So it's a synergistic relationship. It's something, it's where we're working towards a common end together. Various parts. What does that various parts thing sound like? It sounds like 1 Corinthians 12, where Jesus begins to describe through Paul what the body of Christ should look like. That all the different parts of the body, the hands, the eyes, the head, the legs, the toes. How many want to be the toes? Those of you that want to be the toes, God bless you. Amen? Listen, it's a very important thing we understand that Jesus spoke about this through Paul and explained there are different parts of the body and we all need each other to function. How can I have a beautiful body? Maybe my waist is like this, you know, 28 waist, you know, all of the things that I think is my body looks like, but I got no arms and legs. What's the point of having it if I've got no arms and legs? Amen? or not asked to see where I'm going. Hey? So we need each other, the different parts of the body. You don't have a unique fingerprint for nothing. It's because there's something unique about you that no one has, that God wants to use in the body of Christ. And the devil's told you for so long, no, you're just empty. You've got nothing to say. You've got nothing to offer. There's nothing you can give. So why don't you just shut up and just keep quiet and just carry on the way you are? Nothing's going to ever change for you. It doesn't matter what that pastor says. They can ramble on and carry on. Nothing's going to change in your life. It's just going to be the same. It's not going to be, you don't have any gifts. There's nothing you've got to offer. There comes a turning point where you say, listen, I refuse to believe that rubbish anymore. There comes a turning point. You see, you can listen to the best preacher. You can listen to the most eloquent speaker. You can listen to all those things. But unless you come to the point where you are prepared to take the steps of faith, not waiting on God, waiting on God. God's waiting on you this morning to take some steps of faith. To say, listen, I'm moving into it and I'm telling it to move. It's not too steep for me to climb because I'm not going to climb it. I'm telling it to get out the way. Why? Because the scripture tells me that I can. Yeah. I've got a unique fingerprint. I need to learn what my voice is. Hallelujah. I've got to learn what my gifts are. Yeah. Many of you already know that, but this is the thing. This is where the body of Christ is. Because the Bible, this is what the prophetic word says. Let me tell you this first. The prophetic word of the now word is that the new move is the move of the saints. What does that mean? It doesn't say the new move of the preacher, the new move of the evangelist, the new move of the apostle. It's the new move, it's the move of the saints. That means the body of Christ. That means the arms, the legs, the toes, the heads, the feet. Everybody coming together in one accord for the common goal, for the common end, which is going to be much better than one person going out there thinking they can nail it on their own, thinking we don't need each other. Isn't it so much easier for people to just say, oh, we don't need each other. I don't know. Boom, boom. Why? Because then you don't have to risk loving. You don't have to risk your heart being hurt. Well, what a way to live. You're going to end up being even more hurt because if you reject people, they reject you. Hallelujah. Eventually, even those in the church. Why? Because it's a synergistic relationship. What is a synergistic relationship? It's a relationship where we work together. That means that it takes two parties or more. That means that it's not just one of us in it. If you're in a relationship and you're continually the one giving, amen? And nothing's coming from the other side, what will you eventually do? You're going to say, listen, this is crazy. I keep giving and giving and giving and nothing's coming from you. Come on, friends, listen, I'm telling you the truth this morning. So whether it's a relationship of husband and wife or husband and husband or wife and wife or whomever you are, wherever you are, it doesn't matter what kind of relationship, whether it's friends or friends, we cannot really have healthy relationships that are properly synergistic according to the word of God that Jesus is calling us to model if it's not a two-way street. Relationships are a two-way street. Does that mean I expect from you what I give to you? No. It just means I expect from you what's inside of you to give.
Yes, amen.
That's all, wherever you're at. What does freely giving mean when we talk about the synergy of this church and the dynamics? It's about saying that I'll give you everything that is inside me to give without expecting anything back from you. But there will come a time where I expect one thing, and that is to see growth. Where I cannot keep giving unless I see that something I'm doing with you, some part of the energy I'm giving you, is doing something in you. Amen. Isn't that true? As a pastor, right? And what are you giving me? I tell you what, you give me so much when I just see you grow. That's all. When I just see you grow, where I see that you understand the concept of what it is to freely give. Freely giving to bring that synergy into alignment means that I am not afraid to be hurt. I'm ready to give whatever it takes. Come back to that song. Come back to those words. We love you. We can't get enough. All this is for you. Everything you and I own, whether we understand it, whether we know it or not, comes from heaven above. comes from the Almighty God. Whether you've worked for it, whether you've earned it, whether you've used your own hands and your fantastic brain to achieve all you have, there is nothing you have without the mercy of God and because of the grace of God. And you'll have much more because of that grace if you've been in this church. Why? Because of, not just because of the apostolic element, forget that. Because the grace extends itself. Why? Let me explain to you what I'm talking about. When we talk about freely giving, friends, when we talk about this whole thing, it's about much more than just coming to church on a Sunday. It's even about much more than your financial giving. It's about coming to a place of healing in your life where you understand what it is to give freely without any expectation. Where you understand that everything you have belongs to God. It's about understanding what this rock, what the house of the Lord is really about. What it really means to be part of a family. What it really means. What does this house do for you? Why do you come on a Sunday? Why do you want to be part of this house? Because I tell you something, I believe what happens is people get so familiar with what they have that they don't even realize what they have. This house that we've built here over 17 or 18 years. For me, it's been 23 years of starting this ministry. That's said in 5 seconds, 2.5 decades almost. When we have something so accessible, we don't always recognize what it means for us. God doesn't just want you to have a house of worship that's like a ritualistic thing. We think it's not ritualistic because we're here on a Sunday and we're not worshiping like the, you know, it's not like, okay, I'm doing traditional worship and five, you know, hymns and the, you know, from a little hymn book and blah, 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 blah. No. We can be ritualistic in many other ways as a spirit-filled church. We can come in here on a Sunday expecting things for ourselves, but not willing to give a thing. We can come in here and we can be part of this family and get and derive so much from this house, and yet not understand or appreciate what it's done for us out there. Let me give you an example. When you talk about being part of this house, part of the family of God, where this very foundation of the cornerstone, the rock of Christ on which everything is built, this is what it means. It is not just a place where you derive spiritual understanding. It's not just a place where you come and you experience a little bit more of a spiritual this and a spiritual that. This is a place where you learn about life. You don't have a school that you can pay enough to do and have what you have in a church, a healthy church, whichever church that would be. You don't have enough. I've been saying this to our leaders even when we've done courses in the past, but you cannot put a value on what the house of the Lord does for your life. I see people come into this house, some of them it's so sad. Once they get what they ask for and what they pray for, they leave because that very thing becomes their idol. That's why I so often wonder why, you know, sometimes I think God doesn't always give us what we want straight away because God knows what we might just do and forsake our first love once we have it. For some people it's partners, for some people it's something physical like a job or a car or whatever it is that their desire has been, that they've been praying for. That's why the Lord desires that the first thing we do is that we desire more of God, because then everything else will be in proportion. But the house of the Lord, what it does for you, what it does for me, is so much more than just give you religious instruction. This word of God is a word for your life. Why? Because it incorporates all aspects. I've seen people come in here, and through godly counsel and godly guidance and the investment of the leaders, investing in those people's lives on a personal scale in every aspect, guidance about their jobs, guidance about their relationships, guidance about everything, guidance about how to invest their money, guidance about salaries, guidance about everything. Pray, pastor, pray, apostle, please can you help me here, please can you tell me. Yes, of course, but what does it do for you, and what do you do for the Lord with it? It teaches you about life. I see people coming in here broken. They're broken. And through the healing of Holy Spirit and the investment of leaders and the love of each other and the time that is invested. I've seen people that have been broken, that have had hardly any income, that have seen themselves as nothing, low self-esteem, coming out of a place of darkness, flourish in every aspect. Suddenly they get great jobs and they see themselves differently. That's the church. It's not just a religious place. It's not just a place I come on a Sunday. It's where I learn and do life. It's where I learn about how to do life. 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 Because God begins to take me on a journey where I learn about all aspects of what it means to live a healthy life through this word. It's mostly all in here. Ephesians is your manual for Christian living. Does it make some sense?
Yeah.
So the thing is that people come in with the wrong understanding, the wrong concept because of what they've grown and understood about what church really is. But that's not what church really is. Being built on the foundation of Christ is firstly being built in His love. And being built in His love means that there are other things that have to be broken down in our lives that have misconstrued what love is, that have misconstrued what life is, that have pulled us down, that have weighed us down, and God begins to take away the heaviness and the loss of spiritual vision and begins to remove the veil from us. And we begin to get a revelation of who we are in Christ. We begin to get a revelation of what life is. We begin to see that life is worth living.
Amen.
We begin to understand that there's much more for us than what we've been told is our lot, or that it comes from three or four generations down. Oh, well, you know, my mom was like this, my grandma was like this, my grandfather, so I guess this is my lot. It is not.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It is not. It is not. The Lord has more. And the church of God is the place where we learn about how all of that happens. But it is the human nature for us to not always see what God has done in our lives until much later. You cannot put a price tag on what the house of God means to you. You can't put a price tag on what this is. It's not an institution first, it's a family. But it's a family that are learning to do life together. We're learning about what it is to serve the great I Am, to be healed, restored, made new, so that we can be all that we are. And so that emptiness that is hung over our heads is gone. Why do others flourish? And I'm sitting here, Lord, because you haven't taken the steps God's commanded you to take. And those steps of obedience are the most fearful thing for some people to do. Because we've had to live all our lives based on whatever, circumstances and this and that. And when you start taking your first steps, it's like a little baby. The first few steps that a little child takes, They just take a few steps and then they have to hold on to something. Or their mom or their dad is right there. Amen? Those of you that have kids, you know what I'm talking about. And then there comes a time where that little kid, she just gets such confidence. She's like, get away from me, mom. Get away from me, dad. Check me. And she's not limping, okay? And she's like walking. She's like, hey, I can fly, you know? Amen? And that is the cutest thing because she gets this little thing of independence and off she goes. Isn't that true? Most wonderful thing to see. Now here we forsake the spirit of independence because it's hindered us in the past. Amen? But we take on a codependence with Christ. We begin to rely. We begin to take Proverbs 3, don't lean on your own understanding. But trust in the Lord with all your heart, your mind, and your soul. Don't lean on your own understanding. But in all your ways, acknowledge God. And God will make your path straight, if I may use the word. Hallelujah. In all your ways, acknowledge. And so you come to a place where you begin to lean on the Lord. You come to a place where you say, Lord, I'm not leaning on my own understanding. I'm not leaning on what I can see. And I'm taking the plunge I'm taking those faith steps. And I'm going to walk up to that mountain and I'm going to tell it what to do. I can't do that unless I know who I am in the I am. And that's why we've had to go from there to here in the series, for us to understand. And being part of the church, you bring all that you are into this greater whole as you become whole. And the fullness of Christ begins to touch your life and move you to a place where it's no longer about me and the selfishness of my desires. See, friends, when we're broken, we're consumed with self. Are you listening to me? It's a natural, it's human nature. When we're broken and we're not healed, we're consumed with ourselves. Amen? As we are healed, we begin to be consumed with the deep things of God. And that's when we come to the place where we say, Lord, I love you and I can't get enough of you because I appreciate who you are and what you've done in my life. All this, Lord, is for you. See, worship, the true meaning of worship is an act of gratitude. This is powerful. So this, write that down. The meaning of true worship is an act of gratitude. It is saying, it's understanding what God has done for me. I can't worship in spirit and truth unless I realize and recognize what God has done for me. And when I realize what God has done for me, I want to freely give. I want to freely give. I want to shout it from the mountaintops. The ones I've just conquered. Amen. No, you know what I'm saying. But when our time is only invested in our own interests, it comes out of hurt, it comes from spiritual immaturity, and there's a need for further healing because that selfishness is not a fruit of the Spirit, do you agree? So where does it come from? It's a fruit of the flesh. And the flesh is the old flesh. And God says, you're a new creation. You've been made new in Christ. Amen? And so the devil's got some of us as Christians living in some of the old creation, and we haven't moved completely into the new. Amen? But really, what the Word says, and this is what Jesus said just a bit further in the very same chapter in Matthew 16, Jesus said to his disciples, and when he was trying to explain to them, this is the bigger picture, if anyone wants to come after me, they must deny themselves. Matthew 16, 24. They must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Now that we know that doesn't mean that we must be crucified because Christ has paid the price. But it's that heart of gratitude. It's understanding what God has done in my life and not taking that for granted. Recognizing that all that I am and all that I have is because of God. It's because of Jesus Christ in my life. It's because of the house of God, my house that God has brought me into, that God has put me into, that God has poured me into and poured into me. Can't put a value on that. And that's when I learn how to freely give of my finances, of my wealth, of everything that I am, because I understand that God has got my back. And there are many of you here this morning and perhaps even online where God is teaching you how to walk, a walk of faith. For many of us, I can tell you now, we've been praying, turn around this, turn around that. There's been so much going on. People have been going through a very difficult time this past year. And they're going, Lord, when are you going to turn it around? We're praying, Apostle. We're praying for change. We're praying for turnaround. I promise you, Apostle, we're praying. I tell you what, Prophet, we're praying. We're praying. The Lord says, stop praying. Do something. Freely give. Freely give. Freely give to the house that you call your house. Don't call it your house if you can't freely give. Hallelujah. I only hear the front row hallelujahing. Can I hear a big amen? Freely give. Freely give. Can I tell you what God's lesson is for us? It's to learn how to freely give. The first thing people think of is, oh, money. Friends, it's always, giving is proportionate. Can I tell you what, when we teach, we aren't even using the word tithe. Forgive me if we do, but we're attempting not even to use the word tithe anymore. And I'm not even talking just about money here. Because otherwise, people can get religious even in a spirit-filled church. We start going, okay, my gross salary is X. Okay, my gross salary is 10,000. Okay, so I must give 1,000. Or it's 10,000 and 50. Okay, I must give 1,000 and what? 1,005 cents. That's how people get. And instead of seeing the bigger picture and freely giving and saying, is that what God has given me? Did God only give me a tenth? What? I thought God promoted me and promoted me and promoted me and gave me this house and gave me this wife and gave me this husband and gave me this job and gave me the spirit that is new.
Hallelujah.
I should have said that first. Can't put a price tag on those things. You can't start working out the investment that God has made in you over these last years and go, okay, because you'll have to give everything. Amen. Come on. Amen. You'll have to give everything you have.
Yeah.
Everything.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
You won't have enough to give. And we're just talking physical. Now let's talk about the giving of the heart. So it's proportionate. Let's say, I don't know, let's say Pastor Bran is working shifts. And he says, you know what, Apostle, I've got this time I can give to the church. What is it you want me to do? Not only this is what I'll do, this is what do you want? What do you need? And I go, oh, that's amazing, Pastor Bran, because he's not a pastor yet, right? I say, amazing, Bran, that's great. We'd love, and his giving is only that he can give 2 hours once a month to help the church, let's say in himself. Of himself, because of his job or whatever. Someone else, proportionate giving. They have all the time in the world. They may work half day. And they're saying, they don't even offer. They say, I can give you an hour once every 2 months. Do you understand? It's like the concept of the widow. Do you understand what I'm saying? See, the role of a servant in the church becoming, it's a whole different ballgame. But when we talk about serving, serving comes out of a heart of gratitude. It comes out of a heart of me understanding what I've been given. What I've been given. Friends, the only reason I talk to you like this is because I know what it is to freely give. You can ask my leaders. They'll tell you. And I'm not just talking about money. I'll give the Lord whatever I have. I mean, we will. But I'm talking about in everything I am. I'm talking about in pouring out myself, even when I've been stabbed in the head and the back and the throat and the whatever by people. Notice I said by people. That's why I love dogs so much. Hallelujah. And I love all of you too. Phew. Do you know what I'm saying? It's not easy, but you learn how to give freely when you realize how God has given you. You know what I'm saying? So when we started the church, I can remember that I used to practice. I mean, I had a full-time, heavy, heavy job. I used to practice for hours. My first sermon, how long was it? 53 hours or something. 53 hours I took to prepare my first sermon. Never forget it. I know exactly. It was Romans 1 to 5. Romans chapter 5, verses 1 to 5. Never forget it. I was so nervous. I had a microphone that was on a boom stand like this. I didn't even hold the mic. I was like this. People that come under this ministry, they don't start there anymore. Why? Because they already have the anointing of years that is being poured out over them, that they can walk up and after 2 years, they are filled with everything that's been poured out into me over these years. I can pour out into them. They don't have to start where I started. They can take off. Hallelujah. That's what Psalm 133 is with the beard of Aaron. Hallelujah. The oil flows down. It drips down. And it's healthy. But we all have to come to the place where we're saying, Lord, I love you. Oh, yeah, I do, Lord. I love you so much. But I'm not giving you anything. I love you, Lord. Bless me, Lord. Bless my house. bless me, Lord. Give me this, give me that, give me, give me, give me. Mine, 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 mine. I'm like those little seagulls in what's the movie?
Finding Nemo.
In Finding Nemo. Mine, 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 mine. And you know what? You can lay claim to anything. You all know the movie, right?
Yes.
That's what we like sometimes. Mine. It's mine. You can lay claim to anything, but do you know what the biblical principle is that gives you legal access? Freely give.
Yeah.
That's all. See, the Lord doesn't expect you to give, like I keep bringing up the widow when I say proportionate giving. For one person, all they have to their name could be 1,000 rand or 100 rand. And so for them to give 20 rand is like, oh my goodness. Amen? And it's 20%, so we're not talking tithes. For somebody that earns 100,000 and they only give 100 rand, are you getting me?
Yes.
Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
It's proportionate giving. It's percentage based. It's got nothing to do with rand value. You cannot put a value on what God has done. So when we talk about giving, let's talk about freely giving. Matthew 16, so Jesus said, anyone that would come after me must deny themselves. So what was Jesus saying? That you must live in poverty? That you must, you know, just give every single thing you have to the church? No, 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 no. God was saying, what was God saying? Deny yourself and take up your cross. God was saying, be ready. Be ready to, do you appreciate, do you understand everything I've given you? Amen? Do you understand? It's about saying, I'm ready to sacrifice, Lord, whatever it takes. I don't have to give my life. I don't have to. It's about saying, I'm willing to freely give. I'm willing to freely give. Can I paraphrase that? Later on in Matthew 16, 22, in fact, it was just before that, Peter tells Jesus, I'll never ever do this. He speaks to Jesus. You can read it there in verse 22, when Jesus said that he needed to go and suffer and be killed, and he tells the disciples this. In verse 22, Peter took him aside and begins to rebuke him and says, never, Lord, this won't ever happen to you. And what did Jesus say? Jesus said to him, Peter, he says, get behind me, Satan. Why? One minute you see Peter, who's been called the little rock of the church that sits on the giant rock because he had this revelationary understanding of who Jesus is. And the next minute we see Peter turns around and he loses the whole concept. And Jesus has to rebuke him and say, get behind me, Satan. What does that show, friends? It shows the humanness that we can see one aspect but not always have the full aspect, not always have the full picture. That's why we need each other. That's why we need to come alongside each other. And Jesus goes on. I mean, what he was explaining to Peter, he said to him, you're a stumbling block. All of a sudden, he was going to be the little rock in the church. And now he's saying, you're a stumbling block to me because you don't even mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. Friends, in order to freely give, you have to be a people. You have to be a people that understand a revelation and have a revelation of Christ and the vision for your life. You have to have a revelation of what you're doing here. What is the purpose? To bring restoration through the healing power of Christ, leading all of God's people into the, read it with me, into the
wholeness.
And wholeness of the abundant life to which everyone has been called. In and through the supernatural power of Holy Spirit. There's the vision of your church. Do you know the vision of your church? Are you living in that vision? Do you believe in that vision for your life? Has God done anything to restore you? Have you been brought to another level in this church? Amen.
Yeah.
We can all say amen.
Yeah.
Because we know it's true. In Matthew 13, Jesus said, whoever has will be given more, and they will have abundance. Whoever doesn't have, everything will be taken from them. What on earth did that mean? It's proportionate. It's proportionate. In Acts 2:42, this is the purpose of this is a general purpose statement for the global church. It's a commonly known thing, Acts 2:42, which is this. They devoted themselves, this is what the disciples, the apostles did. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship and to the breaking of bread and to prayer. They devoted themselves. Friends, you can't devote yourself ritualistically anymore in the new dimension of David's tabernacle. The Bible says this. There were no needy persons among them. From time to time, listen to this, those who owned lands or houses sold them, and they brought the money from the sales and put it at the apostles' feet. And it was distributed to anyone as they had need. When you see people, and you might have seen it, you may not have seen it on TV programs, you see sometimes people coming and they actually put money at the feet of the apostles. It's not because they're doing this. They understand the principle of honor. They understand what is coming through that apostle into their lives, or the pastor, whomever it is. But because it's a biblical scripture, they came and laid at the apostles' feet. They understand the concept of freely giving as to what's coming back. Amen? It's not a gamble. It's not like, okay, if I give the church, you know, 100,000 rand, I'm going to get 500,000. You know, it's not that kind of thing. You don't gamble when you give to the Lord. It's a sure thing. It's a sure thing. I have been through so much teaching by the Holy Spirit in this last 2014. My faith, you know, when the Lord gave me the word about our church, Isaiah 54, the tent pegs being stretched, verse 2, that scripture was about our faith being stretched and tested and pulled, because it's when we moved into our new place. Amen? And we're in this together, amen? You heard that song by Al Jarreau, we're in this love together. We're in this together. Hallelujah. It's not, oh, well, you know, I'm in it when it's the going's good, but when the going's bad, I'm out of here. Oh, my gosh, there are only 100 people in church today. Oh, my gosh, there are only 50. Oh, no, I'm not coming back next week. I don't want to stick out. Well, what about the difference you can make? Bring more people. Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yes. Imagine if when there was a time in our church where there were 5 people. I am not kidding you. I would preach as though there were 500. Because if the Lord's given me the mandate, I'm not going to change what I say and what I do and minimize it, because every person that's there needs to hear exactly what everyone else that's been disobedient needed to hear. Hallelujah. Are you hearing me this morning? I'm giving you a very powerful word this morning. I'm teaching you about what this church is for. So here it carries on in Acts. Sold a field and brought the money and put it at the apostles' feet. And now, I've already given you that one. Go to Acts chapter 5, and I'm going to read verse 1 to 4. Now read it with me, people. This is important. Now a man named Ananias, read it with me, together with his wife's... I'm glad to know you got it right. Some say Sapphira, but you can say Sapphira. No one's going to link you in. So now a man named Ananias, together with his wife, Sapphira, also sold a piece of property. Keep going. With his wife's full knowledge, listen to this, he kept back part of the money for himself. But he brought the rest and he put it at the apostles' feet. So he's a good guy, right? I mean, you're talking about selling an entire property and putting most of it at the apostles' feet. Don't you think that's a good deal? I mean, then Peter said, Ananias, how is it that Satan has so filled your heart that you've lied to the Holy Spirit and have kept for yourself some of the money you received for the land? Keep going. Didn't it belong to you before it was sold? And after it was sold, wasn't the money at your disposal? What made you think of doing such a thing? You have not lied to people, but you've lied to God. When Ananias heard this, he fell down and he died. And great fear seized all who had heard what had happened. Friends, I'm not giving that to you so that you can have fear or the fear of God. We don't live under fear, amen. We live in faith, right? Yeah. I'm reading this to you because I want you to understand something. There was a principle here. There was no such thing as tithing anymore in the New Testament. people came and they gave as Holy Spirit instructed them to live. There are churches just down the road from here that might have only a couple of hundred people initially. But all the business people got together, and what they did was they took a huge chunk of their profits, and for $25 million, they built the church absolutely debt-free.
Oh, yes.
How on earth did they do that? Did all the people in the church give? No. But the ones that had gave freely.
Yes.
And why? Because they said, this is my house. They took possession of it. They said, listen, I'm part of this. This is part of me. I'm involved here. And that's what all of you are when you come in and you become a member. You're not a Sunday Christian. You're part of this house. And it's part of you. Part of what happens in here is inside of you. Now use it. And come to the Lord and say, Lord, I love you. You will feel so much better about yourself when you start doing stuff for the Lord. Who can vouch for that? I tell you what, you know what they say, when you're idle and your hands are idle, you even get more depressed. But you start doing stuff for the Lord and you are lifted, your spirit is lifted. You start thinking, hey, you know what? I made a difference today.
Yeah.
I made a difference. All of you that came to the camps, you made a difference. You made a difference. And you know what? It wasn't easy because there was a sacrifice. Some of us took Saturdays and sacrificed that time and said, you know what? Now, don't feel guilty if you didn't. There's a time and a season for everyone. I'm just sharing something with you. If you're feeling guilty, guilt comes from?
No.
We're not talking about guilt today, right? So this is just an example. But when you go and you've made that sacrifice, you're not doing it under compulsion. That's not freely giving. When I start giving because I'm like, oh, what are they going to think if I don't give? And no, but when the Holy Spirit convicts you, don't disobey. Don't disobey. Whether it's you giving of your finance, whether it's you giving of, because friends, that doesn't impact your life immediately, but it eventually will. Are you hearing what I'm saying? God's grace is upon all of us, but the abundance of grace is not upon us unless we are obedient to the word of God.
Yeah.
Are you listening to me? With Ananias and Sapphira, I can't tell you. I can't tell you what happened. I don't know why they were struck down dead, but I can tell you now it was a principle. It was the same principle as with the Ark of God. You'd think, oh, but haven't they given enough? They gave basically most of what they had out of the proceeds of their house. Wasn't that? They had committed to everything, and then they held back. Are you with me? The Lord taught us what it meant to freely give this year. I thought I knew what it was because I've always poured into this church. I've bought equipment for the church. I don't need to go into what I've done for this church over the years besides myself. But I can tell you now, last year the Lord took me on a journey and said, now you're going to learn what it is to freely give. And so Prophet and I have been on a long journey. And I want to tell you, we are committed more than we've ever been because we believe in what God has said. But we don't do it alone. We do it with you. We do it together. So that we all can move into the fullness and the wholeness that Christ has for us. So friends, when you come to me and you say, but listen, Apostle, what about giving? What about the financial aspect? I say to you, yes, that's actually the baby part. Do you know that? When we come to financial giving, that should be the first part of our giving. That should be the immature part of our giving. That should be, because the rest is about our own giving. It's about giving of ourselves. The first part is the financial giving. Why? Because the financial giving is a representation of how much you trust God and how you understand what it is to give. You know why I give so much? Because I know that what I'm sowing, I know what I'm sowing is God's got it. God's got the record up there of whatever it is, and it's coming back 100-fold, 1,000-fold. It's coming. It's coming. It's coming.
Yes.
God doesn't forget. Because God looks at the heart. And so friends, when it comes time to offering, don't turn your head away and think because you've pretended to forget that God's forgotten. Hey? God looks at your heart. Do you trust the Lord enough with what you have? Amen? Because that's the baby step. That's the first part of it. It's not about a tithe. It's about every month committing to give what the Lord has put on your heart. And for many of us, it'll be like this, where they gave up half of everything in the book of Acts. Some gave up everything they had. Why? Because they believed and they had the power of Holy Spirit inside of them. They were driven by the love of God. They were driven by what God had done inside them. They could experience and feel and know the change that had come because of the relationship they had with Christ. And they realized there was nothing else that they could put a value to that could do what Christ has done in their lives. Nothing. That's what this house is about. It's not for Sunday sermons and for me to get a little bit of word here and there. It's for me to have life-changing experiences, transformation in my life. Life transformation, we talk about transforming. Where do I put it? Somewhere here. It's supposed to be here somewhere. Well, it's in the website one, right? Life transforming. That's what the church is. It's life transforming. Hallelujah. See, the problem with us is when anybody speaks about money, we start getting all nervous. We go, I'm not listening, can't hear you. Why is money such an issue? Why is it such an issue? What is it? When you die, you can't take it with you. I remember my grandfather had this beautiful big 450 SLC. So many of you know, this is such an old story. It was such a big car. If any of you know what the car looked like in those days, because he had a factory and he made a lot of money in those days. And he retired and he had all this money and he had his 450 SLC and he would have his little cap on and he was quite short as it was. So he had this little cap on and you could hardly see him. And because he got so old, he couldn't see properly over the front. And so he would bash the car. And he would also bash his door because it was a two-door, and so it was so heavy he would have accidents all the time. So he had to buy a smaller car. So he ended up buying a small little car. And by the time he was gone, do you know what I'm saying? The worldly wealth was, because it doesn't mean anything in the kingdom. It means everything to us because we know we need it to live and survive. But friends, if we're going to live hand to mouth and never take a step of faith and never trust God. You know, when I was in PE and I was at that Maldonado conference, every time the offering came up, every session I would give. And I gave quite a lot. Whatever was in my purse, I deliberately put in whatever God had said, put it. And I remember on the last day, I thought I'd already given everything. And on the last day, Maldonado, there was such an anointing when he was speaking. He started saying, listen, I'm passing envelopes around right now, and I'm going to tell you. He said, you need to write what your need is on this envelope. What is it that you're asking God for? And then God's going to give you an amount to put into that envelope, and I'm going to pray right now that you will receive it within. And he gave us an expected amount of time. And I just was convicted. I put that money in, everything that was in my purse, I put it in. Now that takes a lot because you think, am I being brainwashed? What's going on? This is the reality that happens to human beings. You've got to move past that, friends. You've got to move past that. And you know what? Within that stipulated time, exactly what he had spoken about the multiple of, I came back here and somebody said to me, I've just been given an inheritance. They had no knowledge of what I'd been through. They didn't know what God had done with me in the secret place. And they came up to me and said, listen, this is what God's told me to put in. And it was exactly what we needed. I promise you. These are not jokes. But we cannot think we can give a little here and there and satisfy the Lord. Because there is no amount of your money, whether you're a billionaire or not, that can ever satisfy the Lord. Because it's not your money that satisfies your Lord. It's the freely giving of it. It's the proportionate giving of it. And that's why we have to start preaching more about money, because it's such an issue for us as human beings. And we have to get over it. Because it makes us feel like we're powerful or something. And I agree, I understand in a Babylonian system it does. But that's not what it's about. When you learn to freely give of all that you are, your money first, then everything else, you will see what God does in your life. Everything will change. Everything will change. Because your perspective has changed. Amen? So I'm not here to try and talk about money. I don't have to do that. I'm just sharing the word with you. And that's why I mentioned how seriously God takes it. Because when they came to the apostles and they understood what it was. Because their hearts were so freed up by what the Spirit had done. And I think half of us are cold. And that's why we have forgotten We've fallen out of love with our first love, and we have to revive the heart again and get it to that place where we were so excited for the Lord that we were reminded what God's done in our lives, that we can move to the next level of grace. Yeah. Get past the money thing, get past and over everything else, and move into the next level of grace that God has for us. Does that mean something to you? Hey? So the church is not just a place where we come to learn about our faith. It's where we grow in every aspect of our lives, where we learn to be better people through the infusion of the Word and the Spirit operating in our lives, through teaching, through mentorship, through the overseers of the church, through our colleagues, through our peers in the church, through our friends in the church, our family. In the business arena, where we learn more confidence, more self-control, more life skills. Get rid of the chips on our shoulders in the church. Where we learn to be team players. We understand what it is to be team players. And more important than anything else, we learn what it is to be disciples of Jesus. We love you, Lord. Can't get enough of you, Lord. What is for you? What is for you? When I say all this is for you, Lord, what do I mean? What do I mean? You are the rock on which my foundation is built. All this is for you, Lord. All this is for you. For some of you this morning, it's turning a corner. I see this move as a prophetic turning of corners for us. It's turning a corner of the way you see things. It's changed your perspective even of how you've seen church. I'm telling you, there's some of us who psychologically even have distanced ourselves from the church, and we've almost just seen it as this entity that we come to when we feel like it, instead of what it's meant to be, which is the family of God, the place that I learn about life. I learn how to be a better person. I learn how to live life in the fullness of Christ. I learn my true identity and who I am, and the life skills that I have to build on through Christ, the Christ in me, the hope of glory. I learn how to get over my hurts and my issues over the years as God begins to peel the layers from me. I learn forgiveness where there's been unforgiveness that has made me have a bitter heart. I learn how to trust people again. I learn how to get over things like my pride and arrogance and become a person that picks up my cross for another instead of just for myself. I've learned how to deny myself for another. I've learned how to sacrifice. And this morning, the Lord says, above all else, I call you to a place of worshiping me. That when you say you love me, I call you to love me with all your heart and all your mind and all your soul and everything that you are. That I want to move you with my love. I want to shield you with my love. I want to grow you with my love into my likeness, says the Lord. I want to lead you into the fullness that is yours through the sanctuary of my blood. I want to take you to the place in the Spirit where my glory dwells. For I am moving my people, says the Lord, into a move not yet seen on this earth, where things in the Spirit will be seen as commonplace among you, says the Lord. Where signs, wonders, and miracles spoken about long ago shall come to pass. In and through you, yes, you. I speak to you this morning, my children, called by my name. Vessels that I have spoken of over the ages to be led into my glory and to bring a triumphant praise to my name. I've called you out of darkness into my wonderful light, says the Lord. This morning, will you hear my voice? And will you come? Come and build upon the rock. Come and build upon Jesus Christ. Come and be a part of the many. Do not stand on the outside anymore, says the Lord, for I've called you inside. My house is the place I call the womb. This is where I will birth it. And then it will be taken out to the many that need it. They will be brought in, and they will be equipped, and they too will go out and bring in. And my house shall stand, for it is built on Petrus, the giant rock, the rock of your salvation, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Stand with me this morning. We're going to sing that song again, and as we sing it this morning, the Lord is going to speak to your spirit. Some of you may just cry, some of you may laugh, some of you may just experience a refreshing, but I want you to lift your hands as you adore, and as you begin to worship, just let the word that I've spoken penetrate your hearts and your minds this morning. For God delights in you and wants to see you flourish in every area and aspect. But come and know that this is your house. This is your house. It's not the house that Jack built. It's not the house that Jill built. It's the house that is built by the Most High God. The foundation will stand. Hallelujah. Just tell the Lord this morning. Lord, I come to you this morning. I can't hear you. Lord, I come to you this morning, everyone. And I want to declare that I love you. I ask you, Lord, revive the flame in my heart. I want to be on fire for you. I want you to be my first love always. Help me to keep that priority, Lord. I ask you to fan that flame of my desire for you this morning. Right now, the Spirit of God is on you. I see the walls being torn down in the hearts of people where your hearts have grown cold, not because you don't love the Lord, but hearts have grown cold because there's been obstacles in your way and they have deterred you and they've pulled down aspects of your faith. And I speak restoration over you this morning. If that's you right now, you're saying, Lord, oh God, revive, revive, revive. If that's you this morning, just come up right now. Just come up right now. The Lord, I feel such an anointing on this. Just come up right now. God is going to restore your hearts. Just come up right now. Don't let anything settle in your hearts. Just come up. 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 Don't be afraid. Just come up right now. All of you, come. God's going to touch you. There's an anointing here right now. You can feel it as you come to the front.
And when you walk into the room, everything changes. Everything changes. Darkness starts to tremble at the light that you bring. When you walk into the room, every heart starts burning. Nothing matters more than just to sit here at your feet and worship you.
By this message, join Pastor Deborah next week for another exciting word.